Well, good evening, friends, and our listening audience. Good evening once again. At this time, there's an opportunity for all of us to participate in, and we're going to start our first song by singing "Take My Life and Let It Be Consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my hands, take my voice, take my silver, take my heart, take myself."
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my silver hand and move at the impulse of Thy love, at the impulse of Thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful. Voice and let me sing, always only for my King, always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages from Thee. Take my silver and my gold, not the would I withhold. Take my lips and make it Thine, it shall be no longer mine. Take my heart and it's Thine own, it shall be Thy royal throne, it shall be Thy royal throne. Take my love, take myself, and I will be ever only, Lord, for Thee, ever only, Lord, for Thee.
All right, let's look at "To God Be the Glory, Great Things He Has Done," number 141 in the Adventist Church Hymnal.
God be the glory, great things He has done. So loved He the world that He gave us His Son, who yielded His life and atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He has done. Oh, perfect submission, repurchased of blood, to every believer the promise of God. Thou vilest offender who truly believes, that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He has done. Great things He has taught us, great things He has done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son.
Amen. And now we're going to march. We're going to march on to glory, to Zion. Come we that love the Lord, and let our joys be known.
Come we that love the Lord, and let our joys be known. Join in a song with sweet accord, join in a song with sweet accord, and thus surround the throne, and thus surround the throne. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, that beautiful city of God. Let those refuse to see who never knew our God, but children of the heavenly King, but children of the heavenly King, may speak their joys abroad, may speak their joys abroad. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. The hill of Zion yields a thousand sacred sweets. Before we reach the heavenly field, before we reach the heavenly field, the golden streets, or walk the golden streets. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God.
All right, we'll be the last verse.
Then let our souls abound and every tear be dry. We're marching through Emmanuel's ground. We're marching through Emmanuel's ground. To fear a world's on high, to fear a world's on high. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God.
All right, let us stand at this time to sing our theme song. I've heard an old, old story, and we'll be hearing that old, old story this week in a new package, but it's an old story of how a Savior came from glory.
I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groanings, of his precious blood atoning, and then I repented of my sin and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and brought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and oh, my love is through him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how came to make the loved boy and cause the blind to see. And then I heard, Lord Jesus, and come to heal the spirit. My arms on Jesus came to make me victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and brought me with his redeeming blood. He brought me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory through the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beneath the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And I was singing the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. Sought me and brought me beneath the cleansing blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and in all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
You may be seated. I understand our health lecturer is not here at the moment, so we may have the opportunity to use some of the time to maybe half of his time, Doc, to sing a couple of songs, and then we can give you some more of his remaining time. Okay? So we're privileged to have our elder bishop on the piano this evening, and he'll be accompanying us throughout the most of the week. So, your favorite song, you give us a number. 27. Number 27. Number 27. One of my favorites too. Rejoice, ye pure in heart. Rejoice, ye pure in heart. Rejoice, give thanks and sing. Your festal banner waved on high, the cross of Christ, your King. Rejoice, 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 give thanks and sing. With voice as full and strong as oceans surging praise, send forth the sturdy hymns of old, the psalms of ancient days. Rejoice, 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 give thanks and sing. With all the angels' choirs, with all the saints on earth, pour out the strains of joy and bliss, true rapture, not bliss myrrh. Rejoice, 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 give thanks and sing. Yes, on through life's long path, still chanting as we go, from youth to age, by night and day, in gladness and in woe. Rejoice, 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 give thanks
and sing.
Just a refrain. Rejoice. Okay, watch the tempo coming up, the last verse.
Praise Him who reigns on high, the Lord who we adore, the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, one God forevermore.
Pick it up.
Rejoice, rejoice.
Watch it.
Rejoice, give thanks, and sing.
Amen. Thank you very much, choir.
As you can see, I am not Dr. Walsh, but we see our doctor, Dr. Leonard Gibbons. And he's here, and if he's willing to come on right now, he can do so.
Everyone. All right, we're gonna do part two. I was rushing, but I'm here. So we're looking at this whole question of lifestyle and as it relates to the spirit-filled believer. And this morning we talked about what the Bible says. You know, there is this connection. There's the physical, mental, and everything works together. But how does it really work together? So we're going to look at some of the what happens in the mind as it relates to these questions of all right. Okay, this is what we talked about this morning. The grace and the recreation and the heart, soul, strength, and mind. What is true sanctification? And I like what the pen of inspirations reveals in Councils on Diet and Foods. She said, true sanctification is not merely the theory, an emotional or a form of works, but a living, active principle entering into everyday life. It requires that our habits of eating, drinking, and dressing be such as to secure the preservation of physical, mental, and moral health, that we may present to the Lord our bodies not an offering corrupted by wrong habits, but a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God. We cannot love God with all our heart and mind and soul and strength while we are loving our appetites or taste a great deal better than we love the Lord. And I'm just going to put a couple of illustrations of actual testimonies. And this lady put it this way: when I smell a hot slice, all I'm thinking about is pizza. Very little holds my attention the way pizza holds my attention. I'm telling you, food talks, all food talks. What should be the centerpiece of our most important attention? It's God, right? God should be the one that really holds our attention and not food. Here's another one. There are days when I dream about food. Do you ever dream about food? I think back to the delicious meals I once had long, and I long to feel the same sense of what? Anticipation, what? Happiness and what? Fulfillment. That talks about relationships, right? Relationships with people that are fulfilling. But how can food be so fulfilling? Or is it truly fulfilling? It adds color to the day, comfort, stimulation, sedation, happiness, the chance to put what? Fun into the day. You can create one more moment of good feeling, but what? It never lasts. And that is the problem. Whatever Satan gives us, well, however it makes us feel in the moment, it never truly lasts. So we want things that actually last. Now, it's an addiction. An addiction, in one way of looking at it, is a relationship with a substance, a process, or person that gets the illusion that real needs are being met through routines. But real needs are not being met, right? It's all an illusion. You feel good for the moment, but it never lasts. And what we want is something that truly lasts. So food cannot take the place of relationships. It can fill us. It can satisfy. So what does spirit prophecy tell us about this whole thing? You need clear, energetic minds in order to appreciate the exalted character of the truth, to value the atonement, and to place a right estimate upon eternal things. You need a what? A clear mind to understand these things. If you indulge in wrong habits of eating and thereby weaken the intellectual powers, you will not make those earnest, self-sacrificing efforts for entire conformity to the will of God, to give you the finishing touch of immortality. You see this connection between the mind and the spirit? So what we do, what we eat, yes, can impact on whether you will perceive and actually make the efforts necessary that you can be totally transformed. It's not a side issue. Intemperate man cannot be a patient man. Does that make sense? Yes, it does. The sin of intemperate eating, and what is that? Eating too frequently, too much, and of rich, unwholesome foods destroys the healthy action of what? The digestive organs, affects the brain, and perverts the what? Your eating can pervert your judgment? Yes. Preventing rational, calm, healthy thinking and action, a fruitful source of church trials. So many of the trials that are in the church are because of the eating habits of the members. Food makes a real serious problem. So the nerves of the brains are diseased by the abuse heaped upon the stomach. And if the nerves in the brain are diseased, then they're going to affect your emotions and the way you behave. The controlling power of appetite will prove the ruin of what? Many, if they had overcome on this point, they would have moral power to overcome how many temptations? Every temptation of Satan. As we draw near to the close of time, Satan's temptations to indulge the appetite will be more powerful and more difficult to resist. So who is behind it all? Satan is behind it all. So what is he doing? He's yielding a man through yielding to Satan's temptation to indulge in temperance, brings the higher faculties in subjection to the animal passions and appetite in the emotional brain, surrendering to control of Satan and becoming a plaything for the enemy. You know toys? You get toys for kids so that they can play with it? And do you know that Satan is using people like toys? Playthings to get their emotions to fight with one another, to destroy them, to separate them from God, to destroy churches, to destroy, the world. And this is what he's doing. He's using food as a tool to bring damnation and destruction to mankind. Stressed, depressed, or tired people tend to grab what? Fatty or sweet foods, which end up increasing what? Stress, fatigue, and depression. So the very thing you take for the problem creates the problem. It's not a solution. It never has been. High-fat diets cause the red blood cells to stick together. And when the red blood cells stick together, you don't get that oxygen transport. And that leads to fatigue, lethargy, and boredom. And so what are you going to be? A frustrated, unhappy, uncaring, or you want to sleep, you don't want to do anything, you snap at people, right? And then you pray and ask God to give you patience right? And then you eat the very food that makes it impossible for you to be patient. Many people are victims of mood swings, food cravings, poor sleep habits, and other emotional problems, not because they are inherently in their personality, but because of poor eating habits. And that's from Elizabeth Sumner, Food and Mood. So a lot of the moods we have are a direct consequence of our choices. And those choices are often the things we really love. And they really taste what? Good. But are they good? Certainly not. Body systems that enable us to eat just enough to maintain energy balance can go out of control when animals and humans have easy access to what? Foods that are high in what? Sugar, fat, and salt. They are hyper palatable. So they create a drug-like effect. They overstimulate the neurons in the brain, take control from you, and you are a plaything of the enemy. In one rodent experiment, they gave them a 10% sugar solution. And instead of drinking water or eating their normal food, they went and just drank that until it killed them, took their lives. And a lot of people are doing the same thing. We go right back to it, an endorphin rush just by putting sugar on your tongue. So the opiates relieve pain or stress. They calm us down, but the effect is never what? Long-lasting. And we want things that are what? Long-lasting, that are enduring, right? We don't want to feel good in the moment, but we want to have a peace that passes understanding, a hope. And when people look at us, they see, man, this something is about this person, right? Something is amazing, right? Because we're making these positive choices. And the food industry is all behind a lot of it. And they say they are the manipulator of the consumer's minds and desires. This is their own words. So they're telling us, you think you're in control, but we are in control. We're controlling you, right? You think you're in control, but you're not in control. We're fixing those creations so that we control you. Food is escape. Escape? Should we be escaping from anything? Growing levels of stress create the need for indulgence and relaxation. Is that a true statement? No, it is not, right? Growing levels of stress creates a need for actually addressing the real stressors in the first place. And food does not control, does not address the stressors in life. Okay, there is a better way. Self-centered activity, exploiting children, giving children all of these sweet things. Do you know what happens? You are setting them up for a lifelong addiction by giving them stuff that they like, but it's not good for them. The more sugar they get, the more they want. McDonald's, Happy Meals, Happy Meals, Happy Meals. Happiness is not in a meal. Happiness is in relationship. And this is what Satan is doing. He is substituting that relationship with him for stuff. For food. No wonder many people don't have power. You come to a sermon, you listen to the sermon, and your stomach is, you know, I want this guy to hurry up and end so I can go and eat, right? What does that say about your relationship with your God? I want to end with this here, and it's the psalmist. Think about it. Oh, we're going to just skip over this. Taste and see that the what? Happy, blessed is the man who takes his refuge in him. So Psalmist was looking out and seeing the addiction in his lifestyle, in the era which he was living. And he wanted to illustrate to these people who were addicted, right, by Satan's false source of happiness. And he said, taste and see that the Lord is good. Then he said, how sweet are your words to my taste? Sweeter than honey to my, and you want to get to a place where you love the word of God more than you love your food. You get in that word and you forget about food. Your heart is moved. When you're at a place where you enjoy the stuff more than you enjoy the word, it's an indication that you are not in him. The Lord is what? The testimony of the Lord is sure. The statutes of the Lord are right. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eye. The judgment of the Lord is true and righteous. Altogether more to be desired are they than what? Gold. Yea, than much gold. Sweeter also than the honey. And the what? It's better than gold. It's better than possessions. It's better than food. It's that relationship with God. My question to you is, do you have it? Or is your relationship with food? Are you here talking about how much you love God, but in reality, whom you really love is food? There's a decision card that you have. And maybe that's for you tonight. You know, Lord, I haven't made you the centerpiece of my life. You know, food has been that centerpiece. And it's been a struggle. And I'm back and forth, up and down. I know what I should do, but I keep doing what I shouldn't do. And Lord, I love this stuff. I love this stuff. But Lord, I want to know how I can love you better than I love it. And I can have this peace and this joy and this oneness with you that lasts the whole day long. I'm not on the roller coaster because I'm in you. And if that is your desire, I just want you to indicate that on that decision card as we move to the next segment of our time here together. And it's important to realize that it takes everything to serve the Lord. Thank you, Lord, for this time. Continually bless us and empower us so that we can know what it is to truly love you like the psalmist said, and that he enjoyed you more than all what he could get from this world. To this end, we pray and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, thank you, Dr. Gibbons, for that message on health. How many of you know, or have, I should say, have heard of Dr. Eric Walsh? How many? Put up your hands. Maybe you found out about him on audioverse.org, at the GYC meetings, general youth conferences. That's where I found out about our dear speaker that will be with us for this week. As we think about the messages that he has spoken thus far, and he will be speaking in the continuing nights, what do we know about Dr. Walsh? We found out that he has graduated from a number of colleges or universities, Loma Linda Medical Hospital and School. But I'd like to let you know that he is, for me, I really don't know him now, but he seems to be a nobody, trying to tell everybody about somebody who can change anybody. And so after his dear wife and companion and singing evangelist for him, Sister Jackie, she will come and give us a word, a song of meditation. And after that, you will hear God speaking through his manservant, Dr. Eric Walsh. Hear ye him.
How many of us are desirous to see no more night? So for his honor and glory. death in heaven will pass away. It's not a dream. God will make all things new. That day, gone is the curse from which I stumbled and fell. Evil is banished to eternal hell. No never crying again, and praises to the great I am. We will live in the light of the risen nations bow down to sing. The only sound is the praises to Christ the King. Slowly the names from the book are read. I know the King. No need to dread. No more night, no more pain, no more tears, never crying again, and praises to the great I am. We will live in the light of the risen Lamb. See over there, there's a mansion that's prepared just for me, where I will live with my Savior eternally. And there will be no more night, oh, no more pain, never crying again, and praises to the great I am. We will live in the light of the risen Lamb. Oh, oh, praises to the great I am. We will live in the light of the
everyone. If you're like me, you're looking for the time when there is no more night and when we can bask in the light of the risen Lamb. Amen? All right, we're going to get right into this. I know in the evenings we're going to try and make sure everybody can leave while there's still some light outside. So we're going to work on that tonight. And tonight, like I said, we're really going to tackle one of the most difficult issues that we face as Christians. And that is, how do we explain to the world the presence of evil? Our scripture reading is taken from the book of Proverbs, chapter 16 and verse 14. Proverbs chapter 16 and verse 4, sorry. The Lord hath made all things for himself, yea, even the wicked, for the day of evil. Again, our message is entitled, If God, Why Evil? Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for this opportunity to study your word. We thank you, Father God, for being better to us than we are to ourselves. And Lord, I ask again that you just make me a nail upon the wall, Lord, a rusty, sorry nail. But upon that nail, Lord, I ask that you hang a portrait of Jesus Christ. Let Eric Walsh not be seen or heard. Instead, Father, let us hear a word from the throne room of grace. This is our prayer in Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen. So we're going to go quickly to the book of John, the first two chapters, the first two verses of chapter 9. One of the most interesting stories of Jesus, and we'll finish it at the end of the talk, but we're just going to look at the first two verses for now. John chapter 9, verse 1 and 2. The Bible says, And as Jesus passed by, he saw a man which was blind from his birth. And his disciples asked him, saying, Master, who did sin, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Who sinned? In the Jewish economy, when you saw someone who was born with an illness or a disability, the belief was that it was punishment for something either the individual had done, or more than likely, something that their parents had done. So as the disciples saw this person, their question was, who sinned? And we do have to be careful. As a physician, you have to be, you know, I've learned to be very careful to blame the patient for their problems. Sometimes what you find is that they grew up in an abusive house. Sometimes they were neglected as a child. You never know what happened to them, why they're in the predicament they have, or even why they have some of the bad habits they may have. But Jesus looks at this situation, and there's a lot revealed from this story, and we'll come back to it at the end of the talk. But his disciples wanted to know who sinned. If bad things happen in the world, what is the cause? Where does it come from? And so the question becomes, why does God allow evil in the world? And I'm going to show you the argument that many have. We talked about God's existence this morning. One of the arguments people have against God is found here. This is David Hume. Some say he didn't actually think of this quote, but he said, he was a British, British philosopher. He said, if God is omnipotent, meaning he has all power, omniscient, meaning he knows everything, and wholly good, whence evil? If God wills to prevent evil but cannot, he is not omnipotent. If he can prevent evil but does not, then he is not good. And then look at his final line. In either case, he is what? Is not God. And there are many people who have left our church and many of the churches of the world because of this kind of thinking. In fact, Hollywood jumped in on it. And this is a picture of the guy who plays Lex Luthor from the DC comic universe in the movie Superman versus Batman. And on the wall, you can see in the background there, you can see where there's this picture. I don't have to show the whole picture, but it's the picture, one of the pictures of the fall, and the picture's turned upside down so that the devil is on the top and the angels of God are on the bottom. And Lex Luthor, who is, many of you would know, this is Superman's arch enemy in the comic books. Lex Luthor asked the same question. If God is all powerful, why doesn't he stop evil? Because if he really was all powerful and he doesn't, he cannot then be all good. And here, introduced to our children, is this idea that, wait a minute, if bad things happen in this world, God can't be God. Let me tell you, if you and if these are this is one of those questions. There are a few. One of those questions that if you cannot address it, you're going to have a difficult time witnessing to a lot of people. So the question, why does God allow evil in the world? And the answer is two words. It's free will. Free will. Now, the reason free will is so important is because there is something that God cannot do that he wants. And once you understand that, you understand why God has to allow not just people to make free will means you are free to choose what happens. You're free to make decisions. So each one of us then can make choices and live our lives. We, as Dr. Gibbons was talking about, we can live our lives where we live and we eat Snickers candy bars. I don't know if they have Snickers bars here, but you eat Snickers bars all day long. You can make that choice. But God not only allows you the choice, he also allows the consequence. And herein is why our world is in such a terrible state. Watch this. Here's some of the things God cannot do. I'll go through these quickly. Number one, God cannot. He can't lie. Titus 1:2, in hope of eternal life, which God that cannot lie promised before the world began. Hebrews 6:18, that by two immutable things in which it was impossible for God to lie, we might have a strong consolation. We have fled for refuge to lay hold upon the hope set before us. If God said the sky was plaid tonight, the sky would turn plaid. He can't lie. Satan can lie. In fact, he's the father of lies. And one of the reasons evil exists in the world the way it does is because Satan uses deception where God only comes with truth. Second thing God cannot do, God cannot increase or diminish in knowledge. It is impossible for God to learn anything. 1 John 3:20, for if our heart condemn us, God is greater than our heart and knows what? All things. God already knows. Number three, what God cannot do, God cannot be tempted with evil and cannot tempt others. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted of God, for God cannot be tempted with evil and tempts what?
No one.
God can't tempt you and he is not temptable. Number four, God cannot what? God cannot change. He is what? Immutable. Malachi 3:16, for I am the Lord, I change not. James 1:17, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and comes from the Father of lights, which in whom there is no variableness, neither what? Shadow of turning. He doesn't change. He doesn't even turn a little bit. That's why some folks say, well, that was then. God is different now. He accepts this. He accepts that. He allows this. No, he doesn't. He doesn't change. Number five, God cannot cease to exist. Isaiah 40 and verse 28, hast thou not known, hast thou not heard that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, he faints not, neither is weary. There is no searching of his understanding. He doesn't get tired. He doesn't get faint. God is not just a God who exists. He is all powerful. Now watch this. Some people think we keep the Sabbath because God rested on the seventh day because he was tired. God did not rest on the seventh day because he was tired. God rested on the seventh day like a lawyer rests his case. God finished creation, looked at the universe and said, I rest my case. God cannot tire. He doesn't get worn out. Some people say, you know, I'm gonna tire God out with these prayers. No, you won't. But here's the sixth and the one that is most important for our talk tonight. Number six, God cannot force you to love him. Did you get that? God can, you listen, you can't force another person to love you either. I know a whole lot of men that think they can, and it has ended in miserable failure. But you can't force someone to love you. God, in all of his omnipotence, in all of his omniscience, if he was to make you love you, it would instantaneously cease to be love. Are y'all getting this? So guess what? What God wants from you is for you to love him. The reason evil exists in the world is because God had to give everything that he created the choice to choose to love him. And hence, what happened is when God gave that choice to everyone, you could choose to love him or you could choose to do what? Rebel against him. And here is where evil is born, in the act of rebelling and turning against God. Because God is not just all powerful, he is all good. Here's what John says, 1 John 4:16. And we have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is what? He is love. That's what he is. And he that dwells in love dwells in God, and God in him. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. Watch this. If you are in God's love and his love is in you, on the day of judgment, you can have boldness, because you won't have to fear the consequences of a life that is lived in the love of God. 1 John 4:18, there is what? No fear in love, but what? But perfect love does what does it do? It casts out all fear, because fear hath torment. In other words, fear creates anxiety. Fear makes you worry. Fear makes you restless. He says, perfect love puts you at peace. He that fears is not made perfect in love. We love him. Why do we love him? Because he first loved us. In this Christian walk, you understand that we have been brought into the presence of God. He's calling for our repentance. He's calling for relationship with us because he loved us first. And our love is a reciprocal love. We return love to God, but we don't originate the love for God. So God gave mankind choice, just as he gave the angels choice, and you could choose to either love him and follow and serve him, or you could choose not to. Evil is not born because of anything God did. Evil is born when his creation chooses to go against God. And why is that? Because God cannot force you to love him. But watch this. One would choose evil. That is a fallen angel named Lucifer. Watch this. We're going to read a little bit about Lucifer. Isaiah 14 and verse 2. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, Isaiah 14, 13, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High, Lucifer in heaven, who was one of the cherubims that covered. He laid over the mercy seat and the Shekinah glory of God, as it is represented in the sanctuary on earth. It flowed onto him. And we're going to read how he was covered in precious jewels, and Lucifer began to believe that somehow he deserved to be there. In fact, after a while, as he lay there across from Michael the archangel, who was Jesus the Christ, as he was laying there with him and serving with him, Lucifer began to believe, I should be in everything he's in. And he was corrupted. The Bible says here, he said, I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like what? I'll be like the Most High. And this decision, I hope you're getting this. It was his decision that brought evil into the universe. Because God gave him complete ability to choose. Here's what Ezekiel says. Ezekiel 28, 12, son of man, take up a lamentation upon the king of Tyrus and say unto him, thus saith the Lord God, thou sealest up the sum full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. Here, the king of Tyrus, who was one of the rulers on earth, is represented as Satan, because Satan was controlling the ruler of Tyrus. Thus saith the Lord, you seal up the sum, you're full of wisdom, you are perfect in beauty. Thou hast been in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was your covering. The sardis, the topaz, diamond, beryl, onyx, and jasper, the sapphire, the emerald, and the carbuncle, and gold. The workmanship of thy tabrets and of thy pipes was prepared in thee in the day thou was created. In other words, not only was he covered in precious jewels, Lucifer was a living, breathing, musical instrument. Some say he could sing 8-part harmony all by himself. He led the choir in heaven. That's how he was created. Ezekiel 28:14 says, thou art the anointed cherub that covers that mercy seat. I have set thee so. God put him there. You are upon the holy mountain of God. Thou hast walked upon up and down on the midst of the stones of fire. You were perfect in your ways from the day you were created till what? Till iniquity was found in thee. Watch this, church. God did not put the iniquity in Lucifer. Lucifer chose iniquity. And this is why we have evil in the entire universe. Ezekiel 28:16, by the multitude of your merchandise, they have filled the midst of thee with violence, and thou hast what? He sinned. Satan sinned first. Lucifer. He was still Lucifer. Lucifer sinned. Spirit of prophecy tells us that he was conniving. He was going behind God's back, trying to talk to angels and convince them subtly that he was really loyal to God while he's trying to lead them away from God. But the problem is it didn't stay in heaven. Revelation chapter 12, 7 and 8 says this. And there was what? War in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels and prevailed not, neither was their place found anymore in heaven. So Satan now is the dragon. The Bible says in verse 9, and the great dragon was cast out. The old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceives the whole world, he was cast out into the earth. And guess what? His angels were cast out with him. 1/3 of the angels were kicked out of heaven. He was kicked out of heaven. And I heard a loud voice in heaven. Now has come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is what? Cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. Do you know when Lucifer was actually once and for all finally kicked out of heaven? At the cross. When Jesus died on the cross and rose from the grave, that was it for Lucifer. His passport to heaven was revoked. He could no longer go like he did in the book of Job. And we know that this happened at the cross because he was accusing the brethren at the time he was kicked out. He couldn't have been doing that before the world began. But watch this, it gets even deeper. It tells you that those who he accused, how did they overcome? They overcame by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto what? Unto death. So at the cross, Lucifer was finally kicked out once and for all. And a warning is given to every single one of us. Therefore rejoice ye heavens and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, for the devil has come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knows what? He has a short time. Here's where it gets crazy. And if you hear me preach before, I say this every time I read this verse. The devil is busy on earth because he knows he doesn't have a whole lot of time. Yet we, the Bible-believing Christians, act like we've got all the time in the world. Let me tell you something, church. Life is short. Time is short. It is now time to make your calling and your election sure. So what has the devil done? He's trying to change up his image. You see, so let me make this clear now. Every time there's a natural disaster on this earth, every pandemic, and I don't have the quotes in here from the spirit of prophecy of how the enemy is able to taint the air with pestilence. All of the disasters that happened. Just again today, I was just looking at my phone and a news alert popped up that there was a mass shooting in a grocery store in Buffalo, New York. I was just talking to you about that this morning, and they don't even know how many people were killed in the grocery store. Right. Satan is on earth wreaking havoc, and somehow God gets the blame. People leave the church mad at God when they don't realize God had nothing to do with it. Lucifer was made perfect, and he sinned. And so much so that they want to convince you now that Lucifer ain't so bad. That's what the world is trying to do. You've got to be careful. Do not be deceived. Listen, there's a TV show called Lucifer. And this handsome guy runs nightclubs, and because they believe Lucifer is in control of hell, this guy now goes around, and when he finds out someone is doing wrong, he makes it his point to go and inflict justice on the person doing wrong. And so what happens? People start to like the devil. The young couple we were doing Bible study with told us they used to watch the show. I've never seen the show. They watched the show, and his Lucifer's brother's name is Michael. And Michael on the show is a no good, useless type of guy. I believe he's like a drug. They reversed it. So they made Michael look like the villain and the bad guy and the addict. And they made Lucifer look like the clean, upstanding, right guy. Do you think that happens by accident? And here's the thing. If we all just evolved, why is it that even the imagery and the ideology of Hollywood and of literature and even of science to some extent literally goes against the Bible? If the Bible is not the word of God, why do they create programming to erase the truths of the Bible? Y'all missing this thing. Sometimes the best evidence that a thing is true is the arguments people place to try and knock it down. In fact, it goes back to rock and roll. I like to show this slide. This album. This is the Rolling Stones. Some of you might remember them. It was probably one of the best, biggest rock groups of all time. Mick Jagger, the front man, and the name of their album was "Sympathy for the Devil." If you've ever read Roger Murnau's book, A Trip into the Supernatural, when he comes out of demon worship, one of the things he says is that they teach that Lucifer is the real victim. You should have sympathy for Lucifer. The demon priests that he worshiped under in Montreal, Canada, back in the 1940s and 50s, around that time, Roger Murnau, while he was in the demon worship, he says they would teach you that, in fact, Lucifer is going to inherit this world, that you should have sympathy for him. Because he's the one getting the bad end of the stick. So how deep does this stuff go? Well, look at this. Salon on the online magazine says, the 18 best songs about the devil. In fact, the guy you see in the picture, his face kind of half cut off, is a rapper from Long Beach, California named Snoop Dogg. I know y'all heard of him. And Snoop has a song called Murder Was the Case. I don't listen to the song, but you can pull up the lyrics. He literally tells the story of how after he was shot, he sold his soul to the devil and was able to get back on his feet. The song, you can Google the lyrics. I should have stuck them in here. But you can Google them and look at them. Murder Was the Case. And there are a lot of songs like this. The devil is working hard. He knows he has but a short time. Look at this one. Why horror films are more popular than ever. Let me tell you something, just the picture alone, I don't like stuff like this. I don't play with no horror movie. You'll never catch me watching one of them. I don't play with the devil like that. Me and him ain't friends. I remember one time we were doing door-to-door work in San Bernardino, California. And one of the groups of young people went to a house and they said, Dr. Walsh, next Sabbath, you got to go with us to this house. I said, oh, yeah, sure. What's going on? They said, the young lady in the house we spoke to said that at night when she goes to sleep, they wake up in the morning and some spirit has rearranged the furniture. I said, what? They said, yeah, we need you to come and pray. I said, listen, my name ain't Shaggy and I ain't got no dog named Scooby. I ain't going over there trying to figure out no murder mysteries and stuff, man. What do you think this is? They convinced me. They said, you got to go. So the next Sabbath, I went over there. And when we sat with this young lady, and she began to tell us, she wanted Bible study. She said, the reason these spirits are in our house, she said, is because my brothers watch horror films, smoke weed, and they commit all kinds of unlawful sexual acts in our house. Don't play with the devil. Look at this, Rolling Stones. Pastor put me onto this article. Rolling Stones, big rock and roll magazine, had this article. Satan, not Travis Scott, is to blame for Astroworld tragedy. TikTok geniuses declare. And so they're mocking the Christians who are saying that, in fact, what happened at Astroworld, you guys heard what happened. There was a big concert in Texas, and eight people died in the stampede. The TikTok video says that demons began to appear and that Travis Scott was calling it. I don't know about any of that. I can't speak to that. But I will say that there's something really did look fishy about that concert, because this looks like you going into the gates of hell here. If I'm there and I'm seeing this guy, I'm like, wait, what is going on? Are they trying to pull me into this thing? And look at his shirt. The people come in blue, and they come out red devils on the other side. And the thing over the thing at the concert said, "See you on the other side." And young people sitting there, children were killed in that concert stampede. I think a 14-year-old girl, maybe even someone as young as 8, but I know at least as young as 14 years old. Let me tell you something, the devil. So when people say, why is there evil in the world? Because Satan chose evil. He chose rebellion. And then he did something even worse in order to infect this world with that same spirit of rebellion and of evil. It's found in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 1. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, hath God said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden. So we know the story. Satan takes control of the serpent, and the serpent begins to speak. It's a beautiful serpent. It's not like serpents today, and it's up in the tree, and it's talking to Eve. I don't think any of the other animals were talking to Eve like this. So she was pulled by the magnetism of the serpent, as well as by the nature and the curiosity around the tree. The woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden. But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. So she is exclaiming to us, her children, Eve's descendants, that she knew she wasn't supposed to touch that tree, that she wasn't supposed to eat that tree. But look at how the devil lies. And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die. For God does know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be what? Open, and ye shall be as what? Gods, knowing good and evil. Satan says, you know what? You're not really going to die. That's the first lie he told. And you know what's deep? They're still telling that lie today. I talk to people, and they're like, no, when I die, I'm going straight up to heaven. I said, no. When you die, you're going to sleep. We'll talk about that from the Word of God later on. This idea that you're immortal is why some people do some of the things they do. They think they're going to live on afterwards. You shall not surely die. He says that you will be as gods. And this is what a lot comes from a lot of the Eastern religion, even in our own churches. You have folk trying to do Christian yoga in our churches. Yoga is sun worship. Read Ezekiel chapter 8 and look at how Ezekiel talks about the sun worship that was being done. And yet here they are. You shall be as gods. That's what they say. You are God. You are divine. The 5% Nation of Islam, the religion upon which most of hip-hop music was born. Jay-Z is a 5%er, the Wu-Tang Clan are 5%ers. Eric B. and Rakim was a 5%er, that going on. Big Daddy Kane, a lot of those big rappers, 5%er, they believe that the black man is God. I always used to ask them when they approached me on the streets of New York trying to tell me to be a father. I say, if the black man is God, why is it so hard for us to get a job? Let me tell you, somebody figure that one out for me. You can make the world, but you can't get a job. Genesis 3 and verse 6. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, appetite comes right back to what you were talking about. When she saw that the tree was good for food and that it was pleasant to the eyes and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And guess what, church? Sin entered the world. Why? Not because God made them sinful, but because they chose to believe Satan's lie and rebel against God. When you see the terrible things happen in this world, please remember Lucifer made perfect sinned. Our original parents, Adam and Eve, made perfect, they chose to sin. Romans 12 or 5 and verse 12 says it like this: wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that what? All have sinned. So you start to get it. Bad things happen. And here's the thing. If God was to say, okay, When someone, you know, when someone messes with someone else and gets them angry and they go and do something, if God stopped the consequences of the choices of man, the universe, and we'll talk more about this in a second, the universe would not fully see what happens when sin is allowed to run its course. You see, what Satan said is God's law is not fear. It cannot be kept. God has stepped back and allowed the consequences of sin. In fact, Revelation chapter 7, 1 through 3, we may touch on it later in the week, but he says that there are four angels holding back the winds of strife. God in his mercy has not even allowed the full weight of the consequences of sin to attack this planet. Patriarchs and Prophets, page 26. Even when he was cast out of heaven, infinite wisdom did not destroy Satan. Since only the service of love can be acceptable to God. Did y'all get that? The allegiance of his creatures must rest upon a conviction of his justice and benevolence. His creatures must rest upon a conviction of his justice and benevolence. The inhabitants of heaven and of the worlds being unprepared to comprehend the nature or consequences of sin, they had never seen sin before, could not then have seen the justice of God in the destruction of Satan. Had God just wiped Satan out as soon as he sinned, people, the beings of the universe, the angels, would have served him out of fear. And you remember what the text says? Perfect love does what? Casts out all fear. God did not want people to serve him because they were afraid of him. Had he been immediately blotted out of existence, speaking of Satan, some would have served God from fear rather than from love. The influence of the deceiver would not have been fully destroyed, nor would the spirit of rebellion have been utterly eradicated. For the good of the entire universe, through ceaseless ages, he must more fully develop his principles, that his charges against the divine government might be seen in their true light by all created beings, and that the justice and mercy of God and the immutability of his law might be forever placed beyond question. Are y'all getting this? He had to let the consequences of sin run their course, so that the entire universe would be able to see how wrong Satan was. You think the unfallen worlds, when they see the violence on this planet? Roger Minot in his book says that the demon priest told him that when wars break out, like the one happening in the Ukraine, that the demons stand on the sidelines of the battlefields and they laugh as they watch men tear each other apart. You wonder what they, you know, and the ultimate thing was when they took Jesus to the cross and they crucified him. Can you imagine what the unfallen worlds, when they saw the precious Jesus, who was so loving that he came to earth and was born of a virgin and put in a manger. He was so vulnerable, so loving, lived a sinless life, and then they beat him and spat on him as the demons yelled and mocked in the crowds of people. Satan himself was there. I can imagine that the unfallen angels and the unfallen worlds, when they saw our Savior bloodied, beaten, nailed to a cross, that's when it finally hit them. What Satan was saying was a complete lie. So how do we spiritually begin to try and make sense of a world of evil? Well, there's a few key things to remember. Number one, sin and evil are allowed so that they never happen again, so it never exists again. Nahum 1:9, what do you imagine against the Lord? Right? You mad at God? He says, he will make an utter end. Affliction shall not rise up what? What God has done by allowing sin to run its course is that when this thing is all over, no one in the universe will say, listen, sin is a good option. Rebelling against God, disobeying God, everyone will understand that God's commandments are fair, they're just, and they're true. Ezekiel 28:18, thou hast defiled thy sanctuaries by the multitude of thine iniquities, by the iniquity of your traffic. Therefore I will bring forth, this is what's going to happen to Satan, I will bring forth fire from the midst of thee. It shall devour thee, and I will bring thee to ashes upon the earth in the sight of all them that behold thee. All they that know thee among the people shall be astonished at thee. Thou shalt be a terror, and never shalt thou be any more. It will never rise up again. Satan one day, so let me tell you something. Anytime the devil reminds you of your past, I want you to remember this text and remind him of his future. Fire is going to come from inside of him. We think about the lake of fire and all that. The scripture says fire, he's going to combust into flames. And the whole universe is going to watch. Here's the one who brought empires to their knees. Now he's powerless and he's burning. And we who are saved will never have to think about death or sin or evil. You're going to be in a pearly street, inside the pearly gates and on the golden street. You got to worry about somebody running up in your mansion with an AK-47 and a mask laying you down trying to steal your heavenly manna. You can leave your door open at night. Proverbs 16:4, the Lord hath made all things for himself, yea, even the wicked for the day of evil. Now you can make sense of this text. It's a tough text, but the text means this. God has allowed all these things to happen. He's allowed it all to happen. He himself knows what's going on. He's allowed even the wicked to be wicked. Why? Because there's a day of evil coming when all of it is going to be wiped out. Great Controversy, page 88. The whole universe will have become witness to the nature and results of sin and its utter extermination, which in the beginning would have brought fear to angels and dishonor to God, will now vindicate his love and establish his honor before a universe of beings who delight to do his will and in whose heart is his law. Never will evil again be manifest. So listen, when you see the terrible things happening in this world, know that Jesus died on Calvary's tree so that it can one day be eradicated and we will have a universe of peace. She continues, says the word of God, affliction shall not rise up the second time. The law of God, which Satan has reproached as the yoke of bondage, will be honored as the law of what? The law of liberty, a tested and proved creation, will never again be turned from allegiance to him whose character has been fully manifested before them as fathomless love and what? An infinite wisdom. Nobody will even think to rebel. Evil will have, in a sense, served its purpose. Everyone will see that this is the consequence of going against God. In fact, he was a God of love from the beginning. So merciful that he allowed Satan thousands of years to make his case. Listen, if you steal something out of a grocery store and go to a court in America, they're not going to give you 1,000 years to figure out how to get out of it. But the other way that you can make sense of evil is that you have to remember God does not suffer. God does not watch this thing and not suffer with us. God suffers along with this planet in all of its darkness and gloom. I remember I was at one of our Adventist institutions, I won't say which one, and the head of one of the departments brought me into his office when he found out I believed in God. It wasn't Oakwood, I mean to say that clearly, but if you listen to my bio, you know which one it is. And he brought me into his office, and he said, how can you believe this stuff? How can you believe in God and Jesus? My eyes are wide open. What are you doing working at Loma Linda? What are you doing here if you don't believe this stuff? The man looked at me and he said, God is a great, he said, God is like a great a doctor in the sky, a great experimenter in the sky, and we are all like rats, and he's just watching us make a mess of ourselves. It was obvious to me that the man had been traumatized by somebody somewhere along the line related to the church. He said, God is just up there watching as we suffer like this. I said, sir, you forget. According to your analogy, God became one of the rats. And he walked among us. And he suffered on earth. In fact, he suffered more than we suffer. So what you're saying doesn't even make sense. Are y'all getting what I'm saying? Watch this. Psalm 56 and verse 8. Does God suffer with us? It says, thou tellest my wanderings. Put thou my tears into your bottle, into thy bottle. Are they not written in your book? Whenever you cry in pain, church, every time you suffer, there is a bottle, David says, that God collects our tears in. There's a book in heaven where he writes down our sufferings. Let me tell you something. Single mother, you don't suffer alone. For some of us who may have lost a loved one, you don't suffer alone. We suffer. As terrible as our suffering is, understand that God suffers as well. Watch this, Luke 19:41. And when he was come near, he beheld the city. And what did Jesus do? He wept over it. He cried over a city that was happy with itself. Like Jeremiah did, like Ezekiel did, like Isaiah did. I could go on and on. The prophets wept over the condition of the people of God. Jesus looked at Jerusalem and he wept over it. Let me tell you something. He looks at some of our lives and he weeps over our lives too. Isaiah 28:21. For the Lord shall rise up as in Mount Perazim. He shall be wroth as in the day of Gibeon, that he may do his work. His what? His strange work. And bring to pass his act. His what? His strange act. The destruction of the wicked is God's strange act. He is not delighted in the destruction of the wicked. God would rather everyone would repent and come to him. In fact, Peter says it. 2 Peter 3:9. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is longsuffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to what? He wants to reconcile us to him. Ezekiel makes it plain. Ezekiel 18:23. Have I any pleasure at all that the wicked should die? Saith the Lord God, and not that he should return from his ways and live? God doesn't want to destroy the wicked. He wants them to repent. That's why we're preaching the gospel. That's why we teach what the Bible teaches. Because we are partnering with God to try and bring those back who have gone away, or those who may have never heard this great truth and gospel of Jesus Christ. Number three, he wants the tabernacle with us. I'll read this one quick. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is what? With men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. Because of the rebellion that happened on earth, when all is said and done, God is going to set up the center of his universe right here on earth. He's going to tabernacle. He's going to dwell with men. In fact, the spirit of prophecy tells us that after sin has been eradicated, man will be closer to God than if sin had never entered the world. Did y'all get that? Because it isn't just that he created us, he also redeemed us. Every time we walk around in heaven and we see Jesus, we're going to see the nail scars in his hands. And we're going to all remember the sacrifice he made. Our bond to him will be stronger than if he had not had to come and die to save us. And he shall wipe away all the tears from their eyes. Remember the tears he collected in that bottle? One day he's going to wipe away the pain you went through yesterday. Ecclesiastes 3:11, he hath made everything beautiful in his time. Also, he hath set the world in their heart so that no man can find out the work that God makes from the beginning to the end. He will make everything beautiful in his time. Listen, I lost my mother to cancer about 15, 16 years ago. And it was one of the most difficult things I ever experienced. But I can tell you one thing. I look forward to the day when God makes things beautiful. Because one day he's going to roll back the sky like a scroll. And as he passes over, the trump of God is going to sound. The voice of the archangel, a shout will come out. And it will call the dead that are righteous back to life. And I know it hurt when I lost my mother. But guess what? One day, my mother's going to come up out of that ground. She's going to have her corruptible flesh is going to put on incorruption. Her mortal flesh is going to put on immortality. And I will be able to spend the ceaseless ages of eternity with my mama. And I got to tell you, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and his righteousness. Jesus. And one of the ways you can make sense of the evil in this world is remember that God is allowing what's happened to allow for redemption. John 3:16-17 says, for God so loved the world that he gave what? His only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Look at the verse 17, it's just as important. For God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him what? Let me tell you something, no matter how wicked this world is, if you can form a relationship with Jesus Christ, you have an exit strategy from planet Earth. And here it is, Deuteronomy 30:15. See, I have set before thee this day life and good and death and evil. The choice now matriculates itself down to each one of us. Lucifer had a choice and he chose wrong. Eve and Adam had a choice and what did they do? They chose wrong. Cain had a choice and what did he do? He chose wrong. Let me tell you something. You will be without an excuse on Judgment Day because you have a choice. I've set before thee this day life and good or death and evil. If you don't like evil, why do you keep choosing it? Verse 16, in that I command thee this day to love the Lord your God, to walk in his ways and keep his commandments and his statutes and his judgments, that thou mayest live and multiply, and the Lord thy God shall bless thee in the land whither thou goest to possess it. Deuteronomy 39:19, I call heaven and earth to record this day against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore choose life, that both you and your seed may live. I'm going to read a few more verses. I've just finished the story on the blind man, but I want to leave with this point strong in your head. You now get to choose. Right? Everyone's upset about why there's evil in the world, but you can choose right and righteousness. You can make a choice that will help to change the universe because God wants you in the new earth. He wants you saved into his kingdom. He doesn't want you to be lost. We've read the texts. John 9 and verse 3 says this. Jesus answered after the disciples said, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? John 9 and verse 3, Jesus answered, neither hath this man sinned nor his parents, but that the works of God should be made manifest in him. Did you hear that? This terrible thing happened to this man, and Jesus said it was allowed so that the works of God might be made manifest in him. Even this terrible earth, all that has happened, when the final analysis comes, it has been allowed so that God's works can be made manifest, so that sin could be put down and out of the universe forever, so that one day God would tabernacle with those of us who have been redeemed. We'll be closer to God than if sin had never existed, and we will be able to spend the ceaseless ages of eternity with the Lord our God. Jesus goes on to say this, because this is the words that are for us. I must work the works of him that sent me. While it is what? The night comes when no man can work. Let me tell you something, church. The night is coming. The work that we were able to do now in peace and safety will one day be done under the most difficult circumstances, the servant of the Lord tells us. And starting tomorrow night, we're going to switch to that. I'll give my testimony tomorrow night. You don't want to miss that. We're going to talk about what I went through when I was persecuted in the United States and put on national television and all the newspapers and how they came against me because I believed the word of the living God. But I'm telling you that a night is coming, church, when no man will be able to work. That's why it's important that we work the work now, Warwick Church, that we finish the work that God has put before us. Jesus said, as long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. And when he had thus spoken, he spat on the ground, made clay of the spittle, and he anointed the eyes of the blind man with the clay. Jesus took the dirt of the ground, spit on it, start messing with it, rolling it up, and put it on the blind man's eye, anointed his eyes. You remember, how did Jesus make man in the first place? Dust of the ground. How did he remake this man's sight? Woo! It's one of the most hands-on miracles Jesus works. He shows you that Jesus isn't just a miracle worker. He's a bioengineer. He was able to reconstruct the man's eyes without surgery. And Jesus said unto him, go, wash in the pool of Siloam, which is by interpretation sent. He went his way, therefore, and washed. And what happened? He came back seeing. Let me tell you something, church. Some of you, Jesus is ready to take the dirt and remake whatever it is that has gone wrong in your life. He's willing to make you over again, remake your character, make you clean, make you fresh, make as if you had never sinned. He's ready to build your character. But you gotta be obedient. He's willing to put in the request and remake you. But he's also asking you to be washed in the pool so that you can see. Jesus is soon to return. You need your eyes wide open. Hold on. Let me say this before we start the music. Sorry. Somebody tonight may want to give their life to Jesus. They may want to make that choice. They may want to choose life. I'm sorry, the Spirit told me to come back up here and say this before she sings. You may want to choose life over death. You may want to choose the Lord over the enemy. While my wife is singing, if you want to make that choice and you want special, or you want special prayer and you want special prayer, there are cards in front of you that you can fill out. But as importantly, while she's singing, if you want to make a decision for Jesus Christ tonight, you want to choose life and good and not death and evil, I want you to join me down front. While she's singing, as the words of the song are sung, move out of your seat and come join me down here.
To see if you're willing
those who have come down front. Maybe there's somebody else you want to give your life to Jesus. That tugging you feel on your heart, that's the Holy Spirit. He's pulling in. Maybe you just need to rededicate your life to him tonight. Maybe you just need to get more serious about your walk with him. But I want you to move out of your seat and come down front and let us pray together. Some others, you may need to give your life to him. Maybe you just, maybe you went away and you haven't been around for a while, but you want to give your life to Jesus. I want to hold on just another 20, 30 seconds. As every head is bowed and every eye is closed, make a decision for Jesus. Choose life and good. Tonight, choose life and choose good. Is there anybody else before we pray? Don't let the devil hold you in your seat. The devil is a liar. Is there anybody else? You want to give your life to him tonight? Anybody else? Don't let him hold you there. Listen, there's nothing in this world, not what anyone thinks, not what anyone has, that is worth what God is going to give each one of us. Take a stand for him tonight. Is there anybody else before we close? As every head is bowed and every eye is closed, Father God, we thank you for this opportunity to study your word. Lord, it's a difficult thing to try and understand how the world is so full of evil. But Father God, we are glad to know now, the Lord, in your love and in your wisdom, one day you will put an end to all evil. Father God, you allow it because you're long-suffering. You don't want anyone to perish. Lord, you're waiting for some of us to give our lives to you. So Father God, I pray tonight for those who have made their way down front, Lord, seal the decisions that they've made. Father God, I ask that, Lord, you bind them in your love. Put a hedge of protection around them. And Father God, fill them with your Holy Spirit. And Lord, cast the devil far away from them. And Father God, there's another group still in the pews. The Lord did not move, even though your Holy Spirit tugged on their heart. Lord, I ask that you give them no rest until they are resting in Jesus. No peace until they find peace that is in Christ. Amen. And Father God, as we leave this place, let us never leave your presence. This is our prayer in Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen. Amen and amen. Amen. You all may be seated. Amen.
We just want to remind you, starting again tomorrow evening at 6 p.m. to 6:45, we will be serving soup and rolls. And remember, the meetings will continue. And like their doctor said, that he's going to give his testimony. So I would encourage us to come and bring someone along with us. Amen? May you have a peaceful journey home. May you get to your destination safely. Consider yourselves dismissed. Thank you. God bless. Like to give an offering, you can. We have offering boxes.